Gordon, please.
Thank you, Brad, and thank you, Oliver and Anya, for setting up and hosting such a great conference. Very happy to see that there's so much interest in the United States, despite what's going on in the real estate markets or in Washington right now. So I want to talk a little bit about investment structures and vehicles. And so as you can see, the non-listed funds are still dominating the US real estate markets. And non-listed funds are typically closed-end funds and open-ended funds. Then we have separate accounts, JVs, and club deals. Separate accounts, JVs, and club deals are more for investors who either have very deep pockets or have extensive real estate experience. And for that reason, I really want to focus today to talk about closed-end funds and open-ended funds, because I think that the German investors either have or will use one of these vehicles to invest in US real estate. So the second slide shows that the closed-end funds that there are more closed-end funds than open-ended funds in the United States. And secondly, that the closed-end funds typically follow a more opportunistic and value-add strategy, whereby the open-ended funds are more core or core plus driven. So in my presentation, before I talk about the specific vehicles, I want to give some general investing considerations for the German investors. Then I want to describe briefly the open-ended, the closed-end and the open-ended funds, discuss some of the investor hot buttons, and last but not least, talk about an alternative investment vehicle which could be very appealing for the German institutional investors. Before a German investor will pick one of these vehicles, the investor should really consider to evaluate the following things. Number one, obviously, the IFMD compliance. Make sure that the manager and the vehicle is actually IFM compliant. The reverse marketing approach is not always the best solution. Number two, tax and regulatory requirements. Oliver will speak later about it a little bit further, more in detail. But there are structures in place right now in the United States, which are very tax efficient, especially now after the FIRPTA changes. Pension fund, if they qualify as qualified pension funds and use a private REIT structure, can actually invest in the United States, very tax beneficial. Alignment of sponsors' interest, investor interest, obviously a large co-investment is always it's always good. Just make sure that this co-investment has limited voting rights, because there could be a potential conflict of interest going forward. Existing of like-minded investors, same thing. As long as things are going well, it's no issue. If things are going south, you want to have investors on your side who share the same long and short-term strategy. So make sure that the investors you're investing with share the same ideas how things should work going forward if there are problems on the horizon. Last but not least, investment strategy and seed investments. Investment strategy or single investment strategy, you don't want to compete with other funds managed by the same manager. The allocation process can be difficult, and you actually want to invest your money, so make sure that there's not a really competing strategy. And seed investments, especially the Germans like seed investments, so you can see what is the manager doing and how is the manager executing the strategy. One thing to be considered is if the seed investment is transferred from one fund to the other, look at the valuation policies, how it's actually valued, that there's not bad news if the next valuation is coming up. Talking about closed-end funds typically are different than the closed-end funds you see in Germany. They are structured as private equity funds, which means you have a limited number of investors. You start with a fundraising period of, let's say, 2 years, and then you have an investment period and a holding period. And at the end, the manager is liquidating and selling that portfolio. You see extension rights, so if the market is going in the other direction, you have the flexibility to react and you can extend the investment period or the holding period. Typically, you have the manager has a year and the advisory board or the investors have another year to extend, for example, the holding period. One thing which is also different to the German market are the valuation policies. In the United States, you have a fair market value approach. And for the closed-end funds, you typically value your portfolio once a year by an independent appraiser. That's very different what's going on in Germany. Then redemption rights, obviously closed-end fund, you cannot really get out. But when you look at the agreement, and especially when you're a regulated investor, there are certain transfer provisions you have in the agreements. So if you use a REIT structure, for example, you can freely transfer your shares to another qualified investor. So there are, in one way or the other, certain redemption rights possible. Subsequent closings, I said before, the closed-end funds are structured as private equity funds, which means you have a first closing, second, third, and final closing. And when you get in at the second or third closing, you typically, for a closed-end fund, pay as cost of carry. A cost of carry is an interest payment, which is 8-9%. Typically, it's close to the preferred return the fund is aiming to achieve. And what does it mean? You basically pay this interest rate and get treated as an investor as of day one. So you're entitled to prior distribution, prior value increases, and your IRR starts on day one, on the day of the first closing. So as an investor, when you get in at the second or third closing, really look at the performance of the portfolio, how have these assets done, in order to evaluate the risk premium you are paying in order to get in at a later point of time. Moving on to open-ended funds. The open-ended funds tend to be larger, and there's a reason for that, because you have to have certain liquidity mechanism in order to make redemption rights possible. Open-ended term means the fundraising in the investment is going on forever till the investors really decide to terminate the fund. So the investors have the right at some point of time to say, okay, the fund is over and the fund should be liquidated. Different to the closed-end funds, the quarter valuation, the valuation is done on a quarterly basis. So you have an independent appraiser or a desktop approach to really value the portfolio on a quarterly basis. When investors came to me and talk about the benefits of an open-ended fund, say I can get out at any time, I always say, be careful with this statement, because yes, the large funds have enough liquidity typically to make redemption requests possible. But at the end, if you look at these agreements, it's really at the discretion of the general partner. So the general partner can allow if an investor can get out or not. So you see that if there's enough liquidity, investors can get out, but if there's not enough liquidity, there's not really a mechanism for the individual investor to force their or its redemption. So keep that in mind. Subsequent closings, if you get in at a later point of time, you don't pay a cost of carry, you get in at an NEV, at the current NEV, which means you're not entitled to prior distributions or prior value increases. Rather, you get in at the current valuation. It's very different to the closed-end fund model. Investor hot buttons, I think these things are the same for an open-ended and for a closed-end fund. So number one, we talked about sponsor commitment. You want to make sure the sponsor is committed, the management team is actually invested. And if you have a larger sponsor commitment, that the voting rights for this commitment are somewhat limited. Management fee and incentive fees. I didn't speak about it beforehand, about the closed-end fund and open-ended funds. The closed-end funds has an acquisition fee. You see acquisition fees, you see management fees, and you see a performance fee, typically preferred return, and then a split when the portfolio gets sold. the open-ended funds, when you look at the open-ended funds, you don't really see acquisition fees. You see a management fee and some performance fee, which is calculated on a rolling forward basis. So if the portfolio achieves a certain return after 3, 4, 5, or 6 years, the manager is entitled to something. Typically, you see then that 50% of this performance fee will be paid out, and the remainder will be held in escrow and will then be paid out if the next period is also positive. Management fee should be charged on invested capital, not really on committed capital, and the incentive fees on a fund-wide basis and not on a property-by-property basis. Approval rights, look at the percentages. What is really a majority? What's a supermajority? Is it 50%, 60%, or 75%? And think about what is really in your favor, and look at your co-investors. What you also see in these agreements for both funds is the GP removal clause. Number one, obviously, if the manager steals money or commits fraud, he can be removed. But more and more investors are asking nowadays for a removal without cause. So even if the manager doesn't do anything wrong, he can be removed by the investors. This process is quite complicated, but gives the investors certain additional control rights, and for example, to force a reduction of management fees if the distribution is not going as expected. On the next slide, I want to talk about the advisory board. In the US funds, you see an advisory board. The advisory board is typically comprised by the larger investors, but I would say always ask what you don't, if you don't ask, you don't get. So always ask the investor to be a part of the manager, to be a part of the advisory board, so that you can get additional control and decision-making rights. I don't want to talk too much about the successor funds. Obviously, the first fund should be invested by 75% or 90% before the manager should have the right to start a new vehicle to avoid competition. Key person event, I think that's quite important. Look who is responsible for the past performance, for the track record. Look as who are really the key person, key manager, the key managers in this vehicle. And if the majority of these people leave, that you have the right to, for example, terminate the investment period. Last but not least, credit facility. When we negotiated our agreements, there was a huge pushback on using a credit facility. A credit facility is something that you basically are allowed to borrow against your subscription agreements to finance certain things. I actually think at a limited use, it is very beneficial for the investors and also for the managers. So if you want to have short-term funding needs like deposits in the United States, hard or soft deposits, or certain capital requirements, a credit facility is a great tool to effectively make investments or fulfill credit capital requirements if it's limited to this use. Last but not least, when you look at the closed-end fund and the open-ended fund, and you want to combine the benefits of both funds, I think an hybrid, I call it the evergreen fund, could be very appealing for German institutional investors. So what means hybrid? You basically keep the closed-end fund or special fund idea that you say you only have a limited number of investors, let's say 10 investors, and you establish a certain maximum cap fund size, but you allow these investors to increase their capital commitments over time. So there's not really a fundraising or investment period. So the investors, if they like the manager, if they like the strategy, can increase their investments over time. Then you establish some sort of lockout period. You say you have to keep the closed-end fund model that you say, okay, no one can get out within the first five, six, 7 years. And afterwards, you ask your investors if you want to continue with the investment strategy. So till then, you have created enough liquidity to redeem or to let investors out who want to get out after 6 or 7 years. But the remaining investors can stay in. So the idea is here, number one, why sell a good asset? If you really have a great portfolio, why selling it? A lot of investors don't really want to get the money back. They want to stay invested. They want to get the distributions. And number two, there's a lot of pressure to get money out. And it's always a very complicated process to select a manager. You have to do due diligence, negotiate, huge legal expenses. So if the manager is actually doing a great job, why not staying and keep invested with him? Another benefit is certainly when you increase your investments, your capital investments, you don't really have to pay a cost of carry anymore. You get in it NEV. You actually have redemption rights. So if you decide after year 7, 8, or 9, there will be a liquidity mechanism for you to get out. My summary and my outlook is basically for the German investors, look at the vehicle, choose your vehicle, which is serves your specific needs. You have to decide, are you an active investor or are you a passive investor? How much really decision-making rights you want to have? How much you want to influence the investment strategy or a manager? Define your investment guidelines. When you look at the LPA agreements, make sure that it's the investment guidelines actually what you want to achieve. Another thing is, what I think is very important is the total expense ratio. It's expensive investing in the United States, especially for tax-exempt investors in Germany. So look at what are the fees, what's gross, what's net, what's the real leakage, the fee leakage, what is the tax leakage, so what's really the net amount, what is getting distributed to Germany. Incentivize your manager. I'm thinking the manager has to be incentivized. He has to be keep on track to really achieve the expected performance. There's no need to really renegotiate all the preferred return structures. And last but not least, I think with Donald Trump, one thing is pretty good. He wants to lower the taxes significantly, the corporate taxes. So, and this will also benefit German investors investing in the United States. So I think going forward, we will see that all the vehicles become one way or the other more tax efficient. Thank you very much.